bill that put a chill through our business communities.
The Honourable Minister of Economic and Rural Development and Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I want to give you a fact, Mr. Speaker, through you to the member opposite, Mr. Speaker. Let's talk about the CFIB, and let's talk about the budget of this government in 2012, the A rating when it came to tax competitiveness that we received from CFIB.
That's the fact.
From CFIB, Mr. Speaker. Those are the facts, Mr. Speaker. Look, this is, do you know what? And Mr. Speaker, all NovaScotia.com, Mr. Speaker. Valerie Payne, Mr. Speaker. I tabled this once, but by golly, I'm going to table it again.
The Honourable Member for Glace Bay.
Mr. Speaker. On Tuesday, the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives recently released a report detailing the damage Harper's austerity measures will have on Nova Scotia. And I was there for that launch, Mr. Speaker, and I can tell you that the numbers truly are very alarming. The Harper Conservatives will cut 2,072 jobs in Nova Scotia. These are on top of the full-time job losses caused by 3.5 years of this government's economic mismanagement. After the Prime Minister's refusal to come to Halifax, the Premier took to Ottawa to meet with the Harper Conservatives. So my question to the Premier, will the Premier outline who he met with and what he discussed with those officials while in Ottawa?
Honourable the Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I'm happy to tell the member for Glace Bay that I met with the Prime Minister, I met with Minister Labelle, who he would know is with Transport Canada, I met with Minister McKay, I met with Minister Kenny, with all of them, I discussed matters within their various portfolios, all of which touch on the economic growth and health of Nova Scotia.
The Honourable Member for Glace Bay on his first supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, Nova Scotians are concerned by this Premier's relative silence on the damage the Harper's Conservatives' austerity measures will wreak on our province. We know the Conservatives are going to cut $2.5 billion from the defence budget. Nova Scotians are worried that the already delayed shipyard project may suffer because of these cuts. In addition to the Conservative cuts, we know a recent managerial shift at Irving has happened, and Nova Scotians are also concerned about the impact this will have on our ability to stick to an already revised shipyard schedule. My question to the Premier, can the Premier guarantee today that there will be no further delays with the shipbuilding contract?
Honourable the Premier.
Mr. Speaker, no, I can't guarantee that. I certainly can't guarantee what the weather will be next week either. There are lots of other things I can't guarantee. What I can say is that we prepare to make sure that we take maximum advantage of the contracts that we have before us, the industrial contracts. That is why we are ensuring that Nova Scotia community colleges are able to train young men and women so that they'll be able to get jobs in the largest industrial contract in our history. It's why we're working with the universities to make sure that we have appropriate numbers of engineers to be able to fill the job requirements, people in IT, people throughout the supply chain that will be able to fit in and make their lives working on those contracts. It is, in fact, Mr. Speaker, why we invested in that contract, one that if the member for Glace Bay had his way, we wouldn't have, and those ships would be built in Quebec or British Columbia or somewhere else, but not in Halifax.
The Honourable Member for Glace Bay on his final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, we have a federal Conservative government implementing severe austerity measures that will cause the loss of over 2,000 jobs. We have a provincial government whose mismanagement of the economy has cost us more than 3,000 collective jobs. There are more Nova Scotians unemployed now than during the recession, and this government's inability to grow the economy, this government's austerity measures, and this government's silence on Harper's cuts will mean things will get worse if this government doesn't change the provincial direction. The launch of this government's Rural Economic Development Task Force is certainly a sign of hope. Though this task force is 3.5 years late, Mr. Speaker, at least the government's finally admitting that its strategies so far have failed rural Nova Scotia. My question for the Premier. Rural Nova Scotia has lost 8,200 people and 4,400 full-time jobs in the last 3 years. Why has he waited so long to act?
Honourable the Premier.
Mr. Speaker, there are 7,600 more Nova Scotians working today than before we came to power, Mr. Speaker. Just recently, in fact, within the last hour, the member for Argyle actually tabled the outlook from RBC. It's already been tabled, so I don't need to table it again, but I would like to point out that what it actually says is that the real GDP of the province next year will double, the employment will increase by 1.2%, that unemployment will go down, that retail sales will increase, that housing starts will increase, and the consumer price index will go down, Mr. Speaker. If you're going to table something and say that it says one thing and it actually says the other, Mr. Speaker, that is no way to instill confidence. In fact, it says the domestic economy in Nova Scotia is doing very well.
The Honourable Member for Bedford Birch Cove.
Mr. Speaker, in a letter sent to the Minister of Community Services on October 18th of this year, the Canadian Federation of Independent Business asked for clarity on the process for repayment to businesses owed money for work completed on behalf of the North End United Community Housing Co-op. In particular, Nova's Doors and Windows is owed over $77,000 and has heard nothing about this outstanding bill. In fact, the total amount owed to the 11 creditors is over $1.1 million. Mr. Speaker, this project ran over budget by millions of dollars. Nova Doors completed the work 2 years ago, and yet they are still haven't been paid. My question to the Minister of Community Services, when is her department going to give Nova Doors and Windows and all the other companies awaiting payment some answers?
The Honourable Minister of Community Services.
Mr. Speaker, first let me explain to the member opposite how it works, because she doesn't understand that. And how it works is the fact that the Department of Community Services and the government provides the funding to North End United. They are a nonprofit co-op who had a board of directors that worked as a board of directors, and they were the ones who made the decisions with respect to the development there, the renovations and so forth. We are the funders. They are the ones who have the legal rights to make the decision, which means that they're the ones who are responsible for the decisions that were made there and what's taking place right now with respect to their issues of finances. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Bedford Birch Cove on her first supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, while the government comes quickly to the aid of big companies and big banks in the province, they're content to let small businesses twist in the wind. Will the minister commit today to ensuring these small businesses owed money by her department get fair treatment?
Honourable the Minister of Community Services.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The fair treatment comes through the legal system, and that's exactly what has been taking place, is that this is a bankruptcy legal issue. It is not an issue of community services or the taxpayers of Nova Scotia. We funded the project. There was issues that took place within those who had the legal right to make those decisions.
The Honourable Member for Bedford Birch Cove on her final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, this government likes to pay all kinds of lip service about small business being the backbone of our economy, but when push comes to shove, they like to shove and push small businesses. They keep leaving them twisting and hanging. They did it in the Southwest, and they're doing it here again. It is unconscionable that these businesses are still owed over $1.1 million for work that was done for a project funded by community services. There is no oversight ensuring this payment. This government makes income assistant recipients account for every bus token they use, but there's no accountability on their own projects. Mr. Speaker, why does this government have a double standard when it comes to accountability?
The Honourable Minister of Community Services.
Mr. Speaker, that absolutely shows you why, when that party was in, that they had a blank check writing to any business, because obviously they don't understand the fact is that are we supposed to write a check to every business in Nova Scotia that goes under, that the government has nothing to do with? See, that gets them upset because they know it's the truth. That's who they are. They're the ones who would just say,
order,
oh, how much?
Order, order. The time allotted for oral questions put by members has expired. I will now recognize the honourable member for Halifax-Chibucto on an introduction.
Mr. Speaker, members will have noticed that we have been joined in the East Gallery by a school group today. I am happy to draw the attention of the House to the presence in that gallery of 22 grade 3 students who come to us from Oxford School, one of the many fine schools located in my constituency. They are accompanied today by four adults, Carolyn Van Gerp, Shahara Mbuldenya, Amy Holland, and Ian Palmer. I would ask if all of our guests would rise and if the members of the House would give them a warm welcome.
The honourable member for Cape Breton North on an introduction.
Mr. Speaker, in the gallery opposite today is a gentleman from my constituency who's up here on business, who is Mr. Duke Fraser, is a great businessman on the north side and a good community-minded citizen. I'd like to get all members of the House to give him a warm welcome.
The Honourable Minister of Education. Introduction is gone.
No.
Howard already did it.
Howard.
Oh, I will recognize the Honourable Member. Okay, who's jumping up? The Honourable Deputy Government House Leader.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, please call public bills for second reading, Bill Number 151, the Workers' Compensation Act.
Public bills for second reading, Bill Number 151, the Workers' Compensation Act. The Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move second reading of the bill, an act to amend Chapter 10 of the Acts of 1994-95, the Workers' Compensation Act. These amendments will work to protect the workers' compensation benefit levels for Nova Scotia's long service coal miners. This province respects and honors the contributions Nova Scotia's long service coal miners have made to our communities. When they are injured or sick due to their work, we have a system in place to provide compensation and support. A recent decision made by the Workers' Compensation Appeals Tribunal has found that a long-standing practice at the Workers' Compensation Board must change for workers receiving a permanent impairment benefit. The decision rendered that if a worker receiving a permanent impairment benefit has a lung function test and sees an improvement in their lung function, their benefit would be reduced. The bill I am introducing today will work to protect the workers' compensation benefits of the province's coal miners who have served 20 years or more at the face of the mine and have a lung impairment. There are over 700 coal miners in the province that meet this criteria. The WCAT decision will not apply to these folks. This group of coal miners has always been treated differently, as they spent most of, if not their entire careers, in an unhealthy, challenging, and difficult environment. The last thing we want to do is to disadvantage this aging group any further. Section 35 of the Workers' Compensation Act was put in place over 30 years ago to protect this particular group of coal miners, and I'm pleased to say that there was all-party support for that. And with this bill, we are working to ensure the benefit process for that group of coal miners remains unchanged. We are restoring the original intent of this long-standing piece of legislation and clarifying a section that was never intended to change. Government has been meeting with the Cape Breton Injured Workers Association as well as with Mr. Birchall with United Coal Miners, and both groups are supportive of the bill that has been introduced. It is important to note that there are workers outside of Section 35 of the Workers' Compensation Act who receive a permanent impairment benefit that could see their benefits reduced. The WCB is working with those workers to ensure that they are knowledgeable about the testing process. So, summing up, the legislation being introduced this afternoon for second reading will work to protect the benefit process for Nova Scotia coal miners who worked most, if not their entire careers, in this province's coal mines and who have a lung impairment because of their work. Those coal miners who have worked 20 years or more at the face of the mine will have their benefit levels protected. Thank you.
Where is it? Okay. The Honourable Member for Glace Bay.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I just want to rise on Bill number 51, these changes to the Workers' Compensation Act, and basically just take a few minutes to talk about what this means. And the crux of my comments would be to certainly commend the minister for this decision. I'm sure that she looked at this and of course, gets recommendations and information from her department and from WCB, and I think this is certainly the right move. I've dealt with, in my 2.5 years as the MLA for Glace Bay, dealt with hundreds of WCB cases. The staff at WCB have been fantastic, and those who represent that department do great work. Now, naturally, they are basically tied by the legislation, so it comes to the legislature and the minister to make changes that are meaningful, that make a lot of sense. So I think that the many of the members and the people who represent the WCB will be happy with these changes, and again, I certainly know a few hundred people in Glace Bay, and there's 700 that will benefit from this decision in Cape Breton, in the mining towns, the communities, Glace Bay, Waterford, the north side, and the west side of the island as well. But I think this is a tremendous thing for us, and I know that the member from Cape Breton West, who was a DevCo employee, will speak to this, but this truly hits home. And I won't, I know I've gone at length about DASCO and DEVCO and our mining history with Bill Davis and J.B. McLaughlin, and that's where it started. And obviously things progressed over the decades and things become more modernized, but this particular legislation that's 20 plus years hits coal miners that would have served for DEVCO and worked under DEVCO in the 60s and 70s kind of range. And we obviously know that with all industries, but in particular with coal mining, the safety standards weren't always up to par. And there was things that the miners exposed themselves to, the coal dust being the most one of the key hazards that were there at the mines during those periods. You know, silicosis, it affects your breathing, it affects you long term. It is a disease that hits your lungs and it impacts your capacity to breathe. Of course, as these miners get older, this certainly is a threat for them and a health concern, and it is a chain effect where if your lung capacity isn't what it is, obviously that impacts the other organs. And I think that you know, with this, I always go back to my dad with DEVCO and the 38 years he was underground, and I tell you, it certainly took its toll on him with his back and his legs and his lungs, because 33 years underground is a long time to be inhaling this dust. And I think that this truly is an example where the industry and the hazards of the industry did negatively impact on those individuals. So I think this is a good decision by the minister. I think that there are many miners that, because of their time, didn't get to enjoy their golden years, because this certainly does take time. It has an impact on their health, and it takes time off their life. So I'm glad that the minister's supporting the former miners of DEVCO. I think this is a great decision, and I just want to have it on the record that I'm happy to be from Glace Bay, where DEVCO was so prominent. This is a good decision. I want to assure all members of the legislature that this certainly is the right thing to do. So with that, I'll take my place. Thanks.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And Mr. Speaker, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to stand and speak to Bill 151, the Workers' Compensation Act, in particular Section 35, which the minister has introduced some changes to. And I want to congratulate the minister for the work that she has done on this. Mr. Speaker, I worked for the Cape Breton Development Corporation for 19 years, and I actually worked underground for about a year of that. And I was at the face and in different areas working with the surveyors. And I want to say that every person in this house should stand and thank anyone who worked underground, because it certainly was a dangerous occupation, an occupation where people put their life on their line day after day to produce quality products for the people of the province of Nova Scotia. And it wasn't just in Cape Breton, as the minister would know and you would know, Mr. Speaker. People in Spring Hill and Pictou County, Inverness County, all over have worked in this mining industry, and it has taken its toll on individuals. So those that have worked underground, today we are making sure that indeed we are looking after their best interest. And I think that the fact that the minister has sat and worked with the Injured Workers Association of Cape Breton Island and also with the UMW to get this to the point where people who have worked at the face for 20 years will not have to worry about seeing their benefits slashed or taken away from them is something that the minister should be commended for. And I'm very pleased to know that indeed there is compassion and interest in what has taken place for the workers that have given so much of their time and their life. You know, it would be not uncommon at this time of the year for a man to leave home and it'd be dark, get on the trip, go underground, spend the shift there for 8-10 hours, and then come back up and it would be dark again and never see the light of day for 5-6 days at a time. So when you think about the energy and the time and the compassion that these people put into their job, because they really were sincere about what they were doing, and they supplied valuable product. They supplied coal that for years provided good quality electricity for this province. They supplied coke, where you, Mr. Speaker, were employed at one time when the coke was used in making steel products, which was again another industry which was a backbone of our economy in Nova Scotia at one point. So for those reasons, it is with great pleasure that I say that our caucus will be glad to support this bill as it moves forward. And congratulations again.
The Honourable Member for Pictou East.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I too would like to stand in this House and support Bill 151. I want to also commend the minister for the great job that she has done here. And I feel that it is necessary for me to stand in the House today because in my blood is over 100 years of coal mining between my father and my grandfathers. 100 years in the Allen Shaft and in the Acadia and in the Drummond. And I really identify with the members from Cape Breton, particularly the member from Glace Bay, the member for Cape Breton West, and you, Mr. Speaker, as well, because all three of you have had a deep connection to the mining industry and the steel industry in Cape Breton. And I particularly, though I don't always agree with the member for Glace Bay on many things, but both his late dad and my late father spent 33 years in the pit, both of them. And I remember the day as an elementary student when I found out that my father was very seriously injured in the pit. And the experience of having a dad that was in hospital after 33 years for weeks and months in Halifax and in New Glasgow, and the strain that there was on the family at that time, because I remember workers' compensation, which was then called workman's compensation, was not all that fair to the workers. And I remember my dad, after about 2 years, getting a check for $1,000 with a letter saying that if the check were cashed, it would be considered to be final payment. And that was a very difficult decision to make when you owed bills for the first time in your life and you had a check in your hand for $1,000. But if that check were cashed, it was the end of any future worker compensation claim. And that, to me, was a very unfair situation. And I am so glad that we have progressed so far beyond that today. And this legislation is an example of how we have moved ahead to protect people from those not-so-good days. But I want to reiterate perhaps a couple of the things that the minister did say, and Bill 151 actually became necessary because of a recent decision by the Workers' Compensation Appeals Tribunal that found that a long-standing practice at the Workers' Compensation Board must change for workers receiving a permanent impairment benefit. And the Minister of Labor and Advanced Education went on to say that the decision rendered that if a worker receiving a permanent impairment benefit has a lung function test and sees an improvement in lung function, benefit would be reduced. Now, Bill 151 will ensure that reductions will not apply, will never apply, to coal miners who have worked for 20 years or more at the face of the mine and have lung impairment. And I think this is a major piece of legislation for the 700 former coal miners, 700 former coal miners who are actually in that criteria. And this is good, very good legislation. And this group of coal miners have always been treated differently, as they spent most, as the member for Cape Breton West put it so well about the dangers. These people who have spent more than 20 years at the face, and the conditions that they worked in, the unhealthy, challenging, dangerous, and difficult environment that they worked in. Now, I mentioned one time before in this house and took a little flack for it, perhaps, for the 5 years that I worked in and out of bootleg coal mines myself, and I was always able to run faster than the Acadia Coal Company inspectors, who actually were former miners and often let me have a head start on them. But I know the dangers from even those small pits that went down about 8 feet and tunneled in for about 20 feet or so. Those were very dangerous situations. But this was brought home to me even more, because in the 1970s, early 1970s, actually 42 years ago, when I was elected as a councillor in Pictou County, in District 13, which had the Thorburn and five surrounding communities in it, and the McBain mine was still operating at that time. And the McBain mine in the Thorburn area was actually going down. And there weren't many employment opportunities other than mining in that community. And as that mine was starting to close, as the councillor in that area, I was asked by the miners to become the chair of the Save the McBain Mine Committee. And I remember going down repeatedly, even taking people from Ontario down into that mine, and the conditions that those men were working under in the McBain mine were, and ironically, we were trying to save the mine, but those conditions were really a tremendous hardship on those that work there. Because unlike some of the other mines in Pictou County, the McBain seam was a very narrow seam. It was very thin seam. More, I shouldn't say narrow. It was a thin seam. And in many, many places, the miners in the McBain worked on their hands and knees to see, and those were the days before there were the cutters at the face, to see those men with pick and shovel digging in conditions that in some places were 4 and 5 and 5.5 feet high. Just a deplorable situation to work in. But we needed jobs so badly. We fought to save that mine, and we were successful in getting another addition to its life. And I remember going to Quebreton, because to get on television in those days, you had to go all the way to Sydney or Charlottetown to get on TV. And I remember, as the chair of the McBain Mine Committee, the Save the McBain Mine Committee, going to Quebreton with a group of miners to go on TV and fight for the saving of that mine. So I'm fairly emotional about this bill, because it gives me an opportunity to talk about my roots. And I don't want to tell too many stories, but after 33 years in the pit, and after about 2 years of convalescence, my father had to take a job as an elevator operator in the Aberdeen Hospital in New Glasgow. And those were the days when you sat on a stool and hit the floors for the various people getting on the elevator. And I always admired my dad so much, because he was so proud of being a coal miner. And he had to take a job to look after his family as an operator of an elevator in a hospital. And then after 2 years, he was promoted to be a maintenance man and became a proud member of QP at that time, after being involved with the miners' union. So my roots go back fairly deep in mining, and I remember Marsh and others that were involved in leadership back in those days. I'm not old enough to remember McLaughlin, but I do remember many stories about Clary Gillis, and I don't know if there's any connection with my name or not, but Clary Gillis was a CCF member of Parliament that my dad thought a lot of, because he represented coal miners very, very well over the years, and was in the House of Commons until 1957. So that's another little add-on. Anyhow, as I am about ready to wrap this up, I do recall many miners that had various degrees of what we used to call black lung. And this is something that we have progressed so rapidly on in recent years in recognizing the ailments that former coal miners have had over the years. So we are restoring the original intent of this long-standing piece of legislation and clarifying a section that was never intended to change. So, Mr. Speaker, what I want to say, and I've probably taken too long in saying it, is that Bill 151 is a good bill with a good intent, and I'm pleased that this NDP government is protecting those 700 coal miners, because I know how hard they worked for their families and for their communities and for this great province of Nova Scotia. So thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you, Minister, for clarifying this so quickly.
If I am to recognize the Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education, it will be a closed debate on Bill number 151, the Workers' Compensation Act. The Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank all my honourable colleagues for their comments. And I'd like to suggest that perhaps we are honouring the work and sacrifices of long service minors covered by Section 35 of the Workers' Compensation Act by our all-party support of second reading. And I thank everyone for that support. Certainly, many people in this House either have personal or are the next generation from long service minors in this province. It was a very dangerous but necessary resource industry in our province, and we're very appreciative of the hard work and sacrifices that those miners have made. So with that, I would like to close debate on second reading of Bill 151 and move it along to law amendments. Thank you.
The question is for second reading of Bill number 151, the Workers' Compensation Act. Is the host ready for the question? All those in favour? Those opposed? Motion is carried.
Bill number 151, entitled an Act to amend Chapter 10 of the Acts of 1994-95, the Workers' Compensation Act.
Order that this bill be referred to the Committee on Law Amendments. I will now recognize the Honourable Deputy Government Host Leader.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, please call Bill 153, Bill 153, the Community Interest Companies Act.
Bill number 153, the Communities Interest Companies Act. I will now recognize the Honourable Minister of Economic and Rural Development and Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, on behalf of the Minister responsible for Agriculture, Minister of Service, Nova Scotia, and Municipal Relations, I would like to deliver the following. Mr. Speaker, I move that Bill 153 be now read a second time. Mr. Speaker, it is my pleasure to begin debate on Bill 153, the Community Interest Companies Act. Mr. Speaker, the Communities Interest Company Act will allow certain businesses formed for a community purpose under the Companies Act to be designated a community interest company. This will provide Nova Scotians with a new option to combine entrepreneurship with a community purpose, and it will give social enterprises greater flexibility to generate investment, making them more sustainable and successful. Mr. Speaker, Nova Scotia is a province built on the strength of its communities. We also have a long-standing tradition of social enterprise dating back to the early cooperative and credit union movements. The belief in community, self-reliance, and cooperation that inspired Moses Cody's Antigonish movement is still inspiring social enterprise across the province today. Social enterprise has a unique and important role in Nova Scotia. They create jobs, provide goods and services that respond to market demand, strengthen our communities, and contribute to the public good. They exist in or serve almost every community, Mr. Speaker, and help make Nova Scotia a great place to live and work. Despite its importance, social enterprise may be an unfamiliar term to many people, but whether Nova Scotians recognize the term or not, chances are that they benefit from social enterprise. In simple terms, a social enterprise is a business whose primary purpose is a public benefit. They are committed to reinvesting a portion of their profits back into the local community or social good. So when social enterprise profit, society profits. Some examples of social enterprise may include farmers markets, community-owned wind farms, and business enterprises operated by charitable organizations to generate funds to support their work. For example, a gift shop operated by a community museum or a bakery operated by an organization that employs Nova Scotians with special needs in order to help develop their skills while investing back into social programs for their benefit. Mr. Speaker, although social enterprise has been in existence for over a century, the last 10 years or so has seen a global trend where the sector is growing worldwide as people seek to create and want to support businesses that contribute to the common good. However, here in Nova Scotia, Mr. Speaker, current legislation does not fully address the unique needs of social enterprises. We need to make it easier for social enterprises to start, to grow, and increase their contribution to the economy and their social mission. When this occurs, the positive impacts for communities in Nova Scotia will also increase. Community interest companies created under this legislation will have characteristics of both ordinary businesses and nonprofits, and they will invest a portion of their profits in pursuit of social, environmental, community, or cultural goals. Mr. Speaker, this legislation also helps fulfill a commitment that our government made in the Jobs Here strategy. Jobs Here recognizes the important role played by social enterprises in Nova Scotia. The role that social enterprises plays in Nova Scotia's economic prosperity. It makes a commitment to facilitate their success. This legislation brings us one step closer to achieving this goal and also provides a new opportunity to serve public needs while growing the economy and creating jobs. Mr. Speaker, in April of this year, this government also announced $2 million in funding to support small business loans for social enterprise through the Credit Union Small Business Loan Program. This funding was the first step in our social enterprise strategy, and together with this legislation paves the road to success by enabling Nova Scotians to be able to respond to the 21st century opportunities and trends. In closing, Mr. Speaker, I would like to acknowledge the work of the Nova Scotia Social Enterprise Working Group, a government and community partnership, for their role in developing this legislation. Mr. Speaker, I will now take my place and look forward to debate on this bill.
Thank you. The chair now recognizes the honourable member for Preston.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, I've completely gone through the bill and read the bill, and it makes me wonder. I'm nervous about this bill. I don't know why, but I'm nervous. I remember Bill 100 come through here and what devastating effect that it had on Nova Scotia business. I remember first contract arbitration, what negative impact this had on Nova Scotia businesses. And I'm going to be interested to see what businesses have to say about this act. It appears on the surface it might be something worthwhile. There are some circumstances that indeed a company could set up to do some things in a province that typically a regular for-profit business wouldn't do. Perhaps it's a situation where a profit organization, a non-for-profit organization, will benefit from this, be able to do things. We just heard from the minister in question period of community services about a non-profit organization that was provided some money to provide a service, and indeed nobody has been paid. So there's not a lot of difference between non-for-profit organizations and businesses in not properly looking after their financial affairs. So I'm quite concerned about this, and the thing that concerns me the most when you go through this act is the lack of the regulations. Now, we've seen the previous Conservative government bring a bill on insurance in Nova Scotia forward and in a minority government, and we supported it and went through. But when the regulations come forward on that bill, it was nothing like had been available during the discussion here in this legislature. So I'm very concerned about this bill. I'm interested to see what my colleagues have to say about it. I hope that the business community will look at this very carefully and see what kind of an impact it has on them. When I read through the act, it appears that this type of operation can do anything a business can. That is a little bit troubling. We have an economy in this province now that is struggling very, very badly under this government, and see job losses. We see big loans going out to companies that are not performing as they're supposed to, and indeed laying people off. Some of them have gone bankrupt, some of them are closing. The list goes on and on. So I'm very skeptical when this government brings something forward that it relates to business and business in our province. So with those few words, I'm going to be anxiously waiting to see my colleagues and the third party are going to say about this, and indeed what people will say in law amendments when it goes to law amendments. And I truly hope that the business community is aware of this, and they can come forward and have their 2 cents put on the record for whatever good it'll do, because this government is going to pass it anyway, and we'll see what kind of effect it has on Nova Scotians. Thank you.
Thank you. Chair now recognizes the honourable member for Inverness.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I will start out by saying we must recognize the good work of community-minded people across this province. Mr. Speaker, where would we be without volunteers? Much of the social infrastructure in our communities was built with the hands and with the vision of these people. And I think about now in my own area, whether it's rinks or ball fields, trails, community centers, those facilities were often built by nonprofit organizations. Now, I know the minister has brought forward, and the Minister of Economic Development has spoken about it today here, that this is about entrepreneurship with a social purpose. And Mr. Speaker, what I would say about that is it's a laudable goal. There's talk of buy local. I think that that's also something that's positive. If we buy, the more we buy local in our local communities, the more we support our local economies. There are some concerns I have with it, and it's there's 3 points or so I'd like to make here.
That's great. Thanks, sir.
The first question that I would raise is, will government protect investors in any of these enterprises? And I know the definition talks about a social enterprise. It's generally understood to mean using business activities to generate revenue for social good. I guess what I would say is there a chance that it could come at the social good of the investor? And what I'm thinking about here, Mr. Speaker, is somebody who could be a senior, who would have some retirement savings, who might be approached in their community by somebody with very good intentions to invest in one of these social enterprises. That investment may not be best for that person. Mr. Speaker, if their savings that they have, that if they're depending on those savings to generate income for their retirement, and if they hand a portion of those savings, say it's a fifth or a quarter of those savings, that could have and say the investment doesn't pan out, that could have a significant impact on that senior's ability to pay their monthly bills. And once that money is gone, Mr. Speaker, it's gone forever. I've worked in the investment industry myself. I've seen people invest in investments where they were given tax credits as an incentive to make the investment. Those investments were made. They're often locked in for upwards of 8 years, which means they can't access the money. And in some cases, the money that was lost in the investment, actually in a lot of cases, the money that was lost in the investment was more than the money that was saved on the tax side when they made the investment to get the tax incentive. So, Mr. Speaker, I raise this as a point of caution, and it may be something the government might want to look at, and maybe they have looked at it. Maybe they'll communicate more detail as we move the bill through the House. But that's something I bring up. We've seen the government, to their credit, bring up forward a bill in this sitting, Mr. Speaker, by the very same minister, to protect people from overly aggressive debt collectors. And we've supported that legislation. We know that that bill was brought forward to protect the consumer. There are consumers we need to keep in mind with this bill, and that's those people. While they may not be consuming at this point, they may be the investor, but they're the same people. And we need to make sure that through, despite good intentions, that those people are not maybe encouraged to make an investment that may not be appropriate for them, which they could very easily make, Mr. Speaker. They'll do it on their own accord. They'll have their own free will to do it, but it may be something that's promoted to them with good intentions and in good faith that may not be suitable for them. The other point I'd like to make is if there is a social enterprise that is really a charity and that charity is having difficulty raising funds to support their cause, I would hope that they wouldn't pass off something that is really a charitable donation as an investment. Because if we have somebody who's making an investment with the expectation of return, and we all know there's risks to investing, Mr. Speaker, but if the returns just aren't there, and it turns out that it's really been more of a gift of charity that the investor has made, that can become dangerous for the very same reason, Mr. Speaker, that you may have people lose money that can't afford to lose it, when that money may be better invested in something that's going to bring them a secure rate of return, whether it's a GIC at the bank or one of various other investments. That's the safest one I can think of, Mr. Speaker. But that's another point I want to bring up. The other point is one of the goals to allow these social enterprises to use CEDIFs, the Community Economic Development Investment Fund. Mr. Speaker, I know there's many organizations in the province that use that vehicle as an incentive, as a way to raise capital for a project or for an initiative, for an enterprise. It's a good vehicle to do that, Mr. Speaker. I would highlight, though, that it's not for everyone. And everyone can certainly get into it. If you have the money and somebody comes to you with an idea and it's set up, they can come to you with the paperwork, Mr. Speaker. You can sign on it, and you can invest in it. And you may even be counseled to invest in it. But, Mr. Speaker, there are situations, again, where people should not be investing in that type of investment. And we can say, well, put the onus on the advisor who's advising the person and let them decide whether or not it's a suitable investment. We can do that, Mr. Speaker. And, yes, there is some protection in that. But I do know there's still the possibility for people who may end up losing money on an investment that was completely done on both sides with good intentions. So I raise those points today, Mr. Speaker, and I hope that the government takes that as something that's constructive and something that they will consider as the bill moves through the House, Mr. Speaker. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll now recognize the Honourable Member for Lunenburg.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm pleased to stand today and speak on Bill 153, Community Interest Companies Act. Mr. Speaker, Nova Scotians have a long-standing tradition of social enterprise dating back to the co-op movement by Moses Cody, as the minister has said. And social enterprises exist in every community across our province, helping to create jobs and goods that strengthen our communities in rural areas and in our urban areas as well, and contribute to the public good. Mr. Speaker, a social enterprise is a business whose primary purpose is a public benefit that this business is committed to investing a portion of their profit back into the local community. Mr. Speaker, in January 2010, under the leadership of the Department of Economic and Rural Development and Tourism, a small group of people across government and across the community gathered to explore conversations around social enterprises in our province. Mr. Speaker, this group, the Nova Scotia Social Enterprise Working Group, met with a number of people and looked at all the different considerations around the world, looked at best practice just to see how this conversation could be informed. And Mr. Speaker, we're acting on recommendations from the Nova Scotia Social Enterprise Working Group. Again, we have shown that our government, once again, is listening to the needs of Nova Scotians. Mr. Speaker, these conversations highlighted an evolving thinking around collaborative approaches, dealing at looking at public policy, finding better ways to address community challenges. At a time when governments and communities are confronting aging populations with more urban populations, many challenges are happening, and increasingly different ways to do things and look at them and looking at best practice is the path to follow, Mr. Speaker. As a concept, social enterprise is using socially and environmentally conscious market-based approaches to encourage economic growth that give back to our communities. Mr. Speaker, Community Economic Development Investment Funds, or CEDIFs, is another form of best practice for supporting social enterprises. CEDIFs allow members of the community to directly invest in a company that will employ locally. New Dawn Enterprises, the Black Business Initiative, the Halifax Hub, and Just Us Coffee are just some good examples of innovative social enterprise models. Mr. Speaker, this type of community investing in community projects dates back many, many decades. In our fishing, in my community of Lunenburg, many of the fishing captains and the merchant owners all invested in various ships so that they had investment in it and shared in the risk taken to do business at that time, and also would share in the profits and challenges. So these very self-reliant individuals really were the ones who created that sort of concept of investing in your own community, and one that makes more sense and one that we're looking at in a different way now. Over the last decade, Mr. Speaker, we've seen a global trend where social enterprise sector is growing worldwide. In 2005, Mr. Speaker, the UK developed new legislation that allowed social enterprises to acquire profit-making status. Acquiring this new status was preceded by a submission to a community of interest statement banning the enterprise from private profit-making, political activity, and outlining how activities will benefit a community and how surpluses will be used. Another example, Mr. Speaker, is how the European Union provides funding for social enterprises to undertake descriptive research focused on social economy. The German government, Mr. Speaker, provides and partners with social enterprises to create jobs in recycling and social services. All of these things are looking at challenges that communities and provinces and states and countries have to deal with in a very innovative way. The Belgian government, Mr. Speaker, also focuses on a partnership with social enterprises on training, while Holland's partnership is focused on providing care for elderly people. Here in Nova Scotia, this bill, this piece of legislation, Bill 153, will make it easier for social enterprises to start, to grow, and to increase their contribution to the economy of our communities. This legislation will also help fulfill our commitment that the government has made under the Jobs Here strategy. Mr. Speaker, this legislation will allow certain businesses formed under the Companies Act and having established community purpose to be designated as quote-unquote community interest companies. This will also provide Nova Scotians with a new option to combine entrepreneurship with social mission, giving these enterprises greater flexibility to generate investment, create more sustainable and successful business. Mr. Speaker, our government has worked with many programs, and some of the provincial programs that have been administered through economic and rural development are the Nova Scotia Strategic Opportunities Fund. This particular fund is one that allows the province to access federal funds, bringing money to our area. The next one I'd like to mention is the Community Economic Development Investment Fund, and this again refers back to our CEDIFs, which we've spoken about already. The Export Ability Program. This is working with professional development and international trade development, Mr. Speaker. We have the go-ahead program, known as GAP, G-A-P, and it helps explore and helps exporters convert their leads into sales, helping cover costs of marketing processing. So these sorts of things are really helping people move forward in their areas. We have the Industrial Expansion Fund, Manufacturing and Investment, Manufacturing and Processing Investment Credit. This is one that has worked in many different sectors in our province and is seeing a lot of success. Mr. Speaker, the Nova Scotia Business Development Plan offers opportunities as well for businesses to review and assess their practices and develop new approaches to help with qualified consultants. The Product and Innovation Voucher Program, Mr. Speaker, is another program that has really helped a lot of people with this credit note. And our new program, Sustainable Procurement, is one that's being looked at by many, many areas in our province. We're also looking at helping students, Mr. Speaker. The Nova Scotia Business Idea Explorer is one such program. And this is helping young people so they understand about what resources are available to young entrepreneurs, a startup basis, market information, and other information that will help them advance in 50 different types of businesses, Mr. Speaker. Another program that we're talking about is Students in Business. Students in Business is a program that takes advantage of how an owner owns a business, and there are loans up to $5,000 that are available to young people. Mr. Speaker, the whole concept of working with businesses that give back to their community, thereby generating profit that will help in other ways to the community, is something that's highly valuable and innovative. And when we were speaking earlier, Just Us Coffee has been one of the most successful ones in our area that has really grown and grown. Mr. Speaker, this government bill, the Community Interest Companies Act, is a very progressive piece of legislation and one that I am very, very proud to support. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. If I am to recognize the minister, it will be to close debate. The Honourable, the Minister of Economic and Rural Development and Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I wish to thank my colleagues for their comments during debate of Bill 153. I am sure the minister will reflect on what they have said. Mr. Speaker, we are committed to making life better for Nova Scotians. This legislation will create new opportunities for Nova Scotians to create businesses that will also advance social goals. This is a good business that will create jobs and help strengthen our economy in its good citizenship that helps make Nova Scotia a great place to live and work. Now, Mr. Speaker, with those few words, I move second reading of Bill 153 and will take my place now.
Thank you. The motion before the host is for second reading of Bill number 153, the Community Interest Companies Act. Is the host ready for the question? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Against? Motion is carried.
Bill number 153, entitled An Act Respecting Community Interest Companies.
Order that this bill be sent to the Committee on Law Amendments. The Honourable, the Deputy Government Host Leader.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I request that you do leave the chair and that we deal with public bills in Committee of the Whole House.
The motion before the host is to adjourn for the Committee of the Whole House. All in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned, but in accordance with rule number 39.1, before I leave the chair, I am appointing the member for Hammonds Plains Upper Sackville as chair of the Committee of the Whole House on Bills. We now will take a short recess.
Order, please. The Committee on the Whole House on Bills will come to order. I now recognize the Deputy Government House Leader.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Please call Bill Number 136, the Green Economy Act.
Bill 136, the Green Economy Act. The Clerk.
Mr. Chair, this bill was referred back from law amendments with certain amendments. It has 8 clauses. Very briefly, the amendments are on page 4, subclause 4.2. A, add after paragraph S the following 2 paragraphs. T, local food consumption is supported and encouraged with the goal of 20% of the money spent on food by Nova Scotians being spent on locally produced food by 2020. And U, local food production is supported and encouraged with the goal of increasing the number of local farms by 5% by 2020. And then there's a consequential relettering of paragraphs T to W as V to Y. And next on page 5, clause 6, in line 1, delete E and substitute D. And in proposed clause 7.1EA, reletter that as DA. Those were the only changes in law amendments.
Shall clause 1 carry? Carried. Shall the remaining clauses carry? Carried. Shall the title carry? Carried. Shall the bill carry? Carried. I now recognize the Deputy Government House Leader.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Please call Bill Number 140, the Transgender Persons Protection Act.
Bill 140, the Transgendered Persons Protection Act. Clerk.
Mr. Chair, this bill contains 2 clauses and was referred back from the Law Amendments Committee without amendments.
Shall clause 1 carry? Carried. Shall the remaining clauses carry? Carried. Shall the title carry? Carried. Shall the bill carry? The bill is carried. The Deputy Government House Leader.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Please call Bill Number 143, the Importation of Wine for Personal Use Act.
Bill Number 143, the Importation of Wine for Personal Use Act. Clerk.
Mr. Chair, this bill was also referred back from the Law Amendments Committee without any amendments, and it contains 2 clauses.
Shall clause 1 carry? Carried. Shall the remaining clauses carry? Carried. Shall the title carry? Carried. Shall the bill carry? Carried. The Deputy Government House Leader.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I ask that you do leave the chair and report back to the House.
Carried, and we will have a short recess.
On the Committee of the Whole House on Bills reports.
That the Committee of the Whole has met and considered the following bills. Bills 100 and 140, 140 and 143 without amendments, and Bill 136, which was reported with certain amendments by the Committee on Law Amendments to the Committee of the Whole without further amendments, and the Chairman has been instructed to recommend these bills to the favorable consideration of the House.
Order these bills be put forward for a third reading. The Honourable, the Deputy Government House Leader.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. That concludes the government business for the day. Request that the House do rise to meet again tomorrow, the hours being from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. The order of business, daily routine, of course, and second reading, bills 155, 156, and 157, and third reading, bills number 136, number 140, and number 143. And if time permits, address and reply. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The motion before the host is that we now do rise and meet again tomorrow between the hours of 9 a.m. and 3 p.m. Is the host ready for the question?
Question.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Against? The motion is carried. We now stand adjourned. We are now at the moment of interruption. Under rule number 5, the topic tonight for late debate, therefore be resolved that the Premier immediately appoint an independent qualified person to draw up terms of reference and call an inquiry into the events at the Nova Scotia Home for Colored Children. And it was submitted by the Honourable the Member for Victoria of the Lakes and the Honourable the Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and it is a great honour for me to be able to speak on the resolution before us now. It's a very, very important one. It is yet another chance for the NDP government to do the right thing and call a public inquiry into the events that transpired over many decades at the Nova Scotia Home for Colored Children. Mr. Speaker, I wish all Nova Scotians had the chance to be here at the legislature a few short days ago when so many former residents of the Home for Colored Children were here to share their experience with us, Mr. Speaker, those of us that sit in the legislature. I know for me it was a great privilege to meet such brave, now grown Nova Scotia men and women who were prepared to share with us the agonizing story and memories of their own experience over decades at the Nova Scotia home. Mr. Speaker, the allegations of abuse, child sexual abuse that have been made at about events at the Nova Scotia Home for Colored Children are beyond description. And we can only imagine how difficult it is for our fellow Nova Scotians to now, as adults, come forward and tell their stories. And they do that, Mr. Speaker, yes, as part of the personal healing process, which we should all encourage, but also because they want to see justice done. They want to see justice done not only for themselves, and not only for that awful time, but also for all time. Mr. Speaker, they know that the courts
order,
will...
Order, please. The chatter is a little bit high in the room. If you have conversations you'd like to carry on, please feel free to take them outside the chamber. The Honourable, the Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. They know that the courts will determine individual examples of guilt or innocence, identify and properly try the perpetrators of such horrible crimes, Mr. Speaker, and they know that the courts will determine what kind of award or compensation or punishment is appropriate by law. But Mr. Speaker, that's what the courts are for. But it is not right for the government of Nova Scotia to tell those victims that that's all there is to it. And I know today the government says, the Premier says, and the Deputy Premier has said that they're weighing all their options and that they'll come to a decision sooner or later. But, Mr. Speaker, how long have the former residents of that home been told to wait? How long have they been told that sooner or later someone might listen to their stories, examine their experience, determine what went wrong? Mr. Speaker, too many times in our province, in our country, in our culture, groups of people that have been victimized or held back or dismissed have been told to wait. Wait for that day, some future day, when maybe someone will have time to listen to their stories and to appropriately deal with the underlying systemic issues that led to such a horrible experience. Mr. Speaker, the government of Nova Scotia today has an opportunity, and I believe has an obligation, to not be that kind of government that tells fellow Nova Scotians, like the residents of the Home for Colored Children, that they too must get to the back of the line. They must wait. That the government will take its time again and hide behind the courts, as they've been told too often. Mr. Speaker, the residents themselves are already concerned about what may or may not happen in a court of law, what the police investigation may or may not lead to in the way of legal charges. The residents of the Home for Colored Children, they are our fellow citizens. They have been put through a horrible experience in their early years. They have heart-wrenching stories about what happened to them. And just as I feel privileged to have been able to hear them directly, as I know other members in this House have, I want all Nova Scotians, in an open and public and transparent inquiry, to hear the same thing. Because only then will not only the individuals involved be given a proper opportunity to heal and put this behind them and move on with their lives with all the help they may still need from the government, but so too, maybe finally, can Nova Scotia as a province heal, learn the lessons, close the file, do the right thing, acknowledge publicly, under the proper examination of a public inquiry, what went so horribly wrong and why. And then to do all we can to ensure that we can once and for all say, never again. Never again in our province. Not in my Nova Scotia. Not in your Nova Scotia, Mr. Speaker. We want a province that, when something goes horribly wrong, doesn't ignore it, sweep it under the rug, act like it didn't happen, put it on the back burner, tell people that they'll have to wait for some future date. We want a province where, in the open light of day, experiences like those at the Nova Scotia Home for Colored Children are examined, no matter how awful, so that individuals can move on and so that our province can move on. And although we can never be proud of what happened in the past there, Mr. Speaker, in fact, we're disgusted by what happened in the past there. The opportunity to build a Nova Scotia confident enough and proud enough to do the right thing today and call a public inquiry and examine what happened publicly and close that chapter in our history in the appropriate way, and to ensure that no other generation of Nova Scotians, young or old, can ever again be subject to the conditions that existed at that time in that place. And that's why, Mr. Speaker, I implore the government to stop the legal arguments, knowing that there are perfectly valid counter-legal arguments that can allow an inquiry to proceed. I implore the government to take this opportunity to show that this is a new kind of province where we can examine these kinds of issues and put them behind us and do the right thing for the victims of the Home for Colored Children and their families, and in fact do the right thing for all Nova Scotians, including the next generation of Nova Scotians, Mr. Speaker. And that's why we have this resolution before the House, to call on the government to get on with the job, to do the right thing, to do it sooner rather than later, to do it now and not tell a whole nother group of our fellow citizens that they have to wait a long time to get justice done systemically for them. And do it the right thing today and call that public inquiry into the allegations and the systemic issues and the problems that led to such an awful situation at the Nova Scotia Home for Colored Children. And that's why we strongly support this resolution.
Thank you. The chair now recognizes the honourable member for Queens.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It is indeed with a heavy heart that I stand in my place to find myself speaking to this very, very emotional issue. And as a member for the past almost 7 years now, I believe that this is the first time that I have been just so overwrought with emotion for this this just horrific issue that many former residents from the Nova Scotia Home for Colored Children are facing. When I looked up in the gallery on Tuesday and looked into the faces of many former residents and some of their supporters with them, I could only imagine what some of the horrific experiences some of them had had to endure in their early lives as children, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, as a survivor of abuse myself and sexual abuse, and certainly not to the degree or not in the same capacity that the people in the gallery have had to relive as adults and to relive every day and every day of their adult life. It also brings a sad reflection to have this incredible, unfortunate story unfold here in our province, and certainly it's not the first time that we have seen stories like this come to public light, Mr. Speaker. We can indeed look all across Canada and we can see that abuse of children, and in particular sexual abuse of children, have happened systematically in places such as the residential schools across this country, Mr. Speaker. We can be reminded of the horrific abuses in the facility, the Shelburne facility for boys, Mr. Speaker. We know that stories have come to light recently about the abuse of children in Scotts, Canada, and even in our minor hockey leagues across this country, Mr. Speaker, and the Roman Catholic Church historically We know Mount Cashel and the horrific stories of children there in that home. So when I looked up in the gallery at the many faces of former residents, I can certainly see their frustration and their want for healing and their want for justice. And indeed, they do deserve that justice and healing, Mr. Speaker. There is not one person on this side of the House and not one person that sits in cabinet that don't strongly feel that the perpetrators of such an injustice to innocent children, and especially those people in positions of authority and responsibility, should not be brought to justice, Mr. Speaker. And I want to make that very clear. We understand the need for the residents, the former residents of the Nova Scotia Home for Colored Children, that they do deserve to be heard, that they are being heard, Mr. Speaker. And we are listening, but it's also important to remember, Mr. Speaker, that it's just not as easy as saying there needs to be an inquiry call today or tomorrow. We have to follow a process that indeed takes into consideration the most the consideration for not only the residents, the former residents of the home, Mr. Speaker, but also the community in general. We need to make sure that when these processes are moving forward, that we don't jeopardize those former residents, that we don't continue to see them, to have them relive their situation as victims, Mr. Speaker. And really, the heart of tonight's debate, I think, is the importance that we ensure that our justice system can adequately protect any Nova Scotian, any child especially, who is a victim of sexual abuse, Mr. Speaker. And we have heard what residents have said. We are indeed listening to those painful stories. And I can tell you, there is probably not a person on this side of the House that hasn't wept in our hearts for the victims, the stories that they have been sharing publicly. They are sharing their stories publicly, Mr. Speaker. And in this House, we cannot forget that. We cannot place blame between opposition members and with the government. We need to be sensitive to these issues. We need to ensure that the appropriate processes are followed so that if there is a decision by this government to move forward with a type of inquiry, that we do it properly, Mr. Speaker, that we just don't jump in with all feet and saying this is what we need to do today. We need to be very careful. We don't want to see what happened in Shelburne take place here with this very, very sensitive and heartbreaking issue, Mr. Speaker. We need to protect those victims, Mr. Speaker, and therefore we need to be very, very careful about how we proceed. Mr. Speaker, no one is arguing here that inquiries are not valuable. We certainly recognize that they can be, Mr. Speaker, but again, we need to be very careful about taking any actions that can interfere with a criminal investigation or a prosecution, Mr. Speaker. And in a case like this, here in Nova Scotia, our friends, our neighbors, some of these residents, former residents, have gone to school with some of us. Some of the former residents have worked side by side with some of us. Some of those former residents are indeed relatives, Mr. Speaker. And we need to make sure that this government proceeds prudently and ensures that any action taken will not compromise the ability of any legal, judicial, or government process in order to do its job, Mr. Speaker. And we cannot re-victimize the victims, Mr. Speaker. We cannot. These former residents, Mr. Speaker, coming out and sharing their stories publicly, I can only imagine the pain. The pain of each and every one of those individuals who have found the strength within themselves to come before media, to come before government, to come before all of Nova Scotians and painfully stand up and share what they experienced at tender ages of 4, 5, 14 years of age, 16 years of age, Mr. Speaker. Those are brave, brave people indeed. And we need to ensure that whatever decision this government makes, it is the right decision. It is the right decision so that we do not see that those people, our friends, our family members, our community members, do not become wrapped up in a political debate back and forth that sees them being re-victimized, Mr. Speaker. Another issue that we've heard, Mr. Speaker, is the statute of limitations. And currently there is a statute of limitations for victims of sexual abuse here in Nova Scotia. The Limitation of Action Act currently imposes a 1-year time frame for most victims of sexual abuse to file a civil lawsuit against the alleged perpetrator. The limit is 6 years for a civil suit against an entity such as an organization or an agency. And our government certainly agrees that this does not go far enough. And last year, our government started to review this act. And over the last several months, Mr. Speaker, the Department of Justice has been conducting a consultation on the limitation of the act. We are listening. We do know that changes need to be made. We do know that we need to do better in this province to protect children, vulnerable to those in positions of authority, vulnerable to those predators who, in their devious minds, for whatever reason, see an opportunity to take advantage of our most innocent, Mr. Speaker. And up in the gallery on Tuesday, we seen the faces of adults who are still experiencing those horrific events. And deep down inside, there is that child, Mr. Speaker. And that's who we need to protect. Mr. Speaker, this has not been an easy topic for any of us here in the gallery, but I can tell you, our government is listening. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll now recognize the Honourable the Member for Preston.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I listened with great interest to the member from the NDP that just spoke, and her emotion with the topic, and I share her emotional frustration with this and the care she has for the people in this situation. I listened very carefully to the leader of the third party talk about this issue as well, and it's a very, very difficult issue indeed for all involved, and for someone to come forward after many years and bring forward the pain and misery they have within themselves, wondering if they did something wrong when indeed they did nothing wrong, all those years before they come forward and admit that they were sexually or physically abused in an institution that should have been protecting them instead of abusing them. It has to be very, very difficult. And I'm sure as this process unfolds, we will see more people that are afraid to come forward. Hopefully everybody does that indeed has had some sexual abuse against them at the Nova Scotia home. The issue is here this evening, and the resolution and late debate resolution was indeed to vote a public inquiry. Now, I've talked to the Nova Scotia home about this, and they fully want a public inquiry. They want an inquiry to clear the air on this situation, to ensure that everything is uncovered, everything is brought forward without interfering with the legal cases that may go forward, either through the justice system for criminal charges or against any civil action that may take place. Unfortunately, the government has not removed the limitations. The honorable member just mentioned that, has not removed limitations for civil action. And I can tell you the people I've talked to that have been abused over the years are very reluctant to talk about this for many, many years. And most times people won't talk about any type of physical or emotional or sexual problem that they've had as a child until that they're quite a few years afterwards, and I've had several people come that have been 30, 40, even 50 years after it's happened, that at that time they're limitedly willing to talk about it. So the statute of limitations, I think, should be lifted on the sexual abuse cases, because it's something that at first, when you talk to people that's had that happen to them, they feel that they did something wrong themselves. So they have to deal with that first. And then they have to realize that indeed they didn't do anything wrong themselves, but then they're ashamed to come forward because of what people may say or think about them as time goes forward. So it's a very, very tough decision they have to come to. And I feel, as our caucus does, that statute of limitations should be lifted on sexual assault charges, or whatever the case may, however you want to put it. But in sexual assault instances, there shouldn't be no limitation on it. That would ensure that people would think twice, number one, before they sexually assault somebody. And number two, would give justice and some kind of relief to people that have been abused sexually, so indeed they can bring this out in the public and indeed get some kind of even apology or financial compensation or whatever the case may be when it went to a court. That would be only for the court to decide. So as we see this unfold, the government I know is investigating this whole situation through the RCMP, and I think that's very important to have that happen and should continue until they've uncovered everything they possibly can and see if they're going to be able to lay any charges, and it'll be interesting to see if they can or not. The civil actions, I believe, really have the right to go forward. Only the government can change that act to ensure that the individuals that want to pursue that route can, and I encourage the government to do that, and we will do everything we can to push the government to do that. But as far as a public inquiry is, it's been asked for by our community, in the community that this happened in. They're asking for this. They want this. They want to see this. They want closure to this. They want to make sure that nobody else is in a situation that would have to suffer through this type of abuse. And I can tell you right now, the management at the Nova Scotia home is the finest quality management that you could ever have. They really are doing a fine job in the community, and they should be commended for the job they've done. If you've seen how they've changed things just in the last few years, in the home itself, its physical structure, the Acoma Center they've put together to bring family members, so if there's four or five children in a family, to keep those children together instead of seeing them split up all over the place and they lose that family structure. And the director, executive director now at the home is actually a former member of the home and actually went to the home when she was a child. And understands what it's like and how important that home is to the people, the young people that come there. And they deal with some very troubled people today, very troubled youth, usually from broken homes or abuse in their homes or whatever the case may be. Some very, very difficult young people to deal with, but they do an excellent job. They really do. And it's important in our community to have a place like the Nova Scotia home. And they're so anxious to get this resolved and resolved to the betterment of the home. Not only about the home, but all the people that are involved. And they want people brought to justice that have done things wrong. They want also to see the people that were abused receive the attention they should receive on this very important topic. So our whole community is behind this. They want to see a public inquiry. They're pushing for a public inquiry, and I think as the days go on, there'll be even more push in that direction. I really appreciate the people that came into the legislature the other day, the victims of the home. It takes a lot of courage to come forward, be on television and in the newspapers about something that's happened to you. It's very personal and very, very difficult to bring forward. So as this situation unfolds, and hopefully, as the minister, the leader of the third party indicated, we don't want to ever see this happen in Nova Scotia again. Should never happen to start. But we never want to see this happen again. So whatever the government does, whatever the home does, whatever the people involved do, it's important that we set a standard in Nova Scotia that stops any of this happening. So it cannot happen. You know there's serious repercussions if you get involved in something like this. You know there's serious repercussions all the way along. And if until that is in place and people understand that, this will never stop. We see on the news some still serious things happening with abuse, sexual abuse with young men and young women. And it's not acceptable in our society. It's not acceptable. You know, a long time ago, things were different, but they weren't right. They weren't right. And today, those things had to be clarified. And only through a public inquiry, along with the work that the investigation will go with the RCMP and every civil suits, this hopefully will clear the case and indeed ensure that the home is clear of this real, really big problem that they have on their hands right now. And I can stress again, we have excellent people working in the home now. We have a director there that's doing an excellent job to redirect the home in a new direction, which is really serviceless a lot of young people in this province. And a lot of people think the home is just for people from the black community, but it's not. It's there for children from all over the province. It doesn't matter what the race is or color of their skin or religious background or anything. The home is there to help those children. And they are doing a fine job today. And it's very difficult for them to work day after day knowing this is over what they do each day and people wondering, you know, are the children there safe? Well, I guarantee you from what I've seen and what I've seen in with their board, an excellent board they have there now, and with the management and the staff that work there now, they care very much about the young people that are there, and they can never do enough to help them and move things forward. Well, Mr. Speaker, I can implore the government of the day here today, the NDP government, to come up with a public inquiry and indeed bring this in the open, get this whole thing cleared up, and ensure that the people that did the wrong are charged or whatever other repercussions are coming to them, those things go forward and this thing can finally be decided. But please call for the public inquiry and hopefully the government will listen and do that. Thank you.
Thank you. I would like to thank all members for their participation in tonight's debate. We are now at the end of the late debate. We are going to adjourn to meet again tomorrow morning at the hour of 9 a.m. We are now adjourned.